Hey everybody, happy Friday! Happy Friday! My shirt's a little goofy there. Anyways, happy Friday. How are you? I'm gonna fix my shirt. It's a little goofy. Anyways, hey, sorry about last week with our travel issues and challenges that we had, and I don't think I like this at all. Anyways, hey, sorry about last week, and hopefully you were able to take advantage of the interpersonal communication video that we posted. It was one of those unavoidable circumstances that we really didn't have control over, but such is life. And here we are today. So what are we doing? Well, we've got executive leaders and directors from all across North America joining us to talk about our next competency. This whole idea, this whole concept of your value and your worth, the incredible difference that you make in communities, and that raising the capacity of your department is really about raising the leadership capacity of both formal and informal leaders within the department. So it's not really just about you and your capacity, but it's also about raising the capacity of all of those around you. Not only those leaders that you have on your team with titles, but also those leaders that you have on your team without titles. And your role in that is about creating culture and environment. Your role in that is not just about you being a better leader, but creating a context where everybody becomes better leaders. Building the public sector one leader at a time. And your role in that is you've got to build great leaders around you. If you're not great at building great leaders, then we're going to have a problem, in my opinion. Because as an executive leader, I would suggest that your matrix of evaluation has very little to do with your own performance. You're evaluated based on the performance of those furthest away from you. Not only the performance of your individual, not only the performance of your department as a whole, which is really the cumulative of the individual performances, but also the impact that it has in the community. And you have got to, in some unique and different ways, marshal the human capital of people outside of your department. Excuse me, and you'll have to forgive me throughout the whole broadcast. I got the flu, Jeff's got the flu, everybody's got the flu, but we're muddling through, we're troopers. But, you know, I think it's really important that we understand that in these changing times, and the nature of leadership today is about getting the best from people, and in your specific instance, it's the best from people within and the best from people without, outside of your department, and marshaling all that human capital and bringing it into alignment. And our visual on that has been over and over again, this arrow, the stated mission of your department, and that, there we go, and that within that, right, it's about getting all those arrows going in the right direction. It's about getting all those arrows headed in the right direction. Now, hopefully you sent out that survey. Hopefully you asked people within the department, hey, how am I doing? What am I doing right? Your suggestions for my improvement. What am I doing wrong? You know, I'm sorry, what am I doing right? And then question number two, what am I doing wrong? Your suggestions for my improvement. And then question number three, if you could send me back to class or school, what class would you make me take? What's that about? How does that relate to this right here? That relates to trying to gain organizational alignment, to ensure that everybody on the team knows what the goal is, everybody on the team knows what their role is, and everybody on the team knows what winning looks like. Right? Well, by getting feedback about your own performance, you're starting to create the preconditions for alignment to occur. Because as we discussed, the only way for alignment to occur or for change to occur is trust. These arrows are not all going to go in the right direction, in the direction that you want, unless they trust you and they trust your organization and they trust the governmental entity. But in today's day and age, there's such distrust between executive leaders and the troops.
And the preconditions are actually in place to create distrust. And whether you've had wage freezes within your own organization, or whether they've heard about it happening somewhere else, whether there's been benefit cuts within your organizations or layoffs, or they've heard it happening somewhere else, there's all kinds of within all of the context around us, there's all kinds of factors that might create distrust or mistrust. But the only ways to get the arrows in alignment, as we talked about in the whole agent of change discussion, is trust. You can't influence those arrows unless they trust you. It's about trusting relationships. So that was our whole conversation the last 3 weeks. Well, I guess it was 4 weeks because of the holiday. So now what? Now how do we continue to marshal human capital and try to gain that alignment between all of the people on your team and all of the people outside of your team that influence or impact what you do every day, so that you can go out and do your noble and honorable work to make a significant impact in people's lives? The next competency is big picture, holistic systems thinking. As an executive leader, you must be a systems thinker. Now, I'll unpack what I mean by that in a second, but I think if you're going to be successful in the 21st century, you must see the big picture, and you must be able to recognize the systems that are in place, evaluate whether they're relevant. If they're not, create new ones. If they are, maintain them. Systems. You see, I would suggest to you there's not enough time, energy, or effort available to you to get done everything you need to get done. And I've felt that as an executive leader, that there just wasn't enough time. There wasn't enough energy. And there certainly weren't enough resources to get done everything that needed to be done, or everything that was expected of me as an individual, or everything that my organization was expected to accomplish. One of the uniquenesses, I guess, of my life has been that I've always been in leadership positions that were beyond my ability, certainly beyond my capacity. I'd always been asked to lead in places where I had no business being. I was either too young, or I was inexperienced, or I lacked knowledge, or I lacked education, or I lacked the tools or the skills. It seems like routinely life has put me in a position where I'm well beyond myself and then asked to lead. And whether that was because of battlefield promotions or happenstance or luck, I found myself in leadership positions well beyond my capacity, routinely, and still do today. And I just think people are drunk and then they put me in the position. I don't know what has caused that, but in a way it's been a great blessing. Because in one of those experiences, that great blessing was feeling overwhelmed, feeling beyond myself, feeling that I couldn't do what needed to be done, and that literally 1,000+ people were counting on me to do it well. But they knew, and I knew, they knew, as well as I knew, that I was beyond my capacity. It was at that time that, and we all have our own, you know, safety net that we turn to. And for me, it's certainly a faith that I turn to, but also I love motivational quotes. I love those little pithy little quotes that you look to give you that moment of inspiration. I remember one evening just desperate, overwhelmed, not enough time, energy, and effort. You know, you've got about 75 roles that you play in your life, and there's just not enough time, energy, or effort to get them all done. From parent to boss to, you know, employer to volunteer to, you know, all the things that you're expected to do that I'm expected to do. Just not enough energy at your disposal. Finite amount of energy and time and effort. So I just felt overwhelmed. And I knew I couldn't do it, and everybody else knew I couldn't do it. So I was looking, you know, quote, I need a quote, pick me up. And I came across this quote by a guy named Archimedes. And the quote was, Give me a place to stand and I will move the world. Give me a place to stand and I will move the world. And I thought, wow, that's powerful. You know, the human capacity, the human ability. Give me a place to stand and I will move the world. That's pretty powerful. And it hit me. Now, you may recall this Archimedes. He was a great Greek mathematician, and he was a great philosopher, and he came up with the concept of buoyancy and so many other things. Give me a place to stand and I will move the world. And I was so struck by that quote that I started to learn more about this Archimedes. And I came to find that Archimedes was the one that came up with the fulcrum and the lever. He was the one that developed the idea that, you know, I could take a stone and I could take a stick and put that stick over the stone and I could use it and I could move something that was significantly more weight than I could move on my own. You saw in that photo what Archimedes was talking about. See, Archimedes' quote, I came to find later, had nothing to do with human capacity. Archimedes was talking about his fulcrum and lever. Give me a place to stand and I will move the world if I have a fulcrum and a lever big enough. Ian, I don't understand. Your sickness must be clouding your conversation because you're not making any sense, Ian. Well, just hang tough with me. So here I am feeling overwhelmed. I hear this quote, give me a place to stand and I will move the world. Then I learned that he wasn't talking about the human capacity. He was talking about the right tool. Give me a place to stand and I will move the world because I'll have a fulcrum and a lever big enough. A force multiplier. Write that down. A force multiplier. You see, Archimedes' fulcrum and lever is a force multiplier, taking what he had and making more of it. Then I came to find out that Archimedes also developed the compound pulley. The compound pulley, another force multiplier. It allows one individual to do the work of 10 people. 10 people. And you see in that picture that Jeff just put on the screen how Archimedes proved or demonstrated his compound pulley. In that graphic, it was a depiction of how Archimedes pulled a boat into the shore through his compound pulley system. You see, the day before, it had taken 10 men to pull that boat into the shore. But Archimedes, the old man, was able to do it through a series of pulleys and rope. Excuse me. He was able to pull that boat into the shore. He was so impressive that people thought he was a god. Was he a god? No. No. I still don't understand, Ian. Well, in those indefinable split seconds, when I started to learn about what Archimedes really meant from give me a place to stand and I will move the world, it dawned on me. I just need the right system. I just need the right tool. I don't have to be the most intelligent. I don't have to be the most talented. I don't have to be the most dynamic. I don't have to be the best in anything. I just got to have the right system. That's what Archimedes was saying to me. Archimedes was telling me, and what I'm telling you is the challenge that we face is that we have a finite amount of time, energy, and resources at our disposal to get done everything we want to get done. So what's the answer? What's the solution? Systems. Simply put, a system is an organized collection of parts that are highly integrated to accomplish an overall goal. That's a system. Highly integrated set of parts that are put together. An organized collection of parts that are highly integrated to accomplish a specific goal or outcome. That's a system. Are you a systems thinker? The 21st century will be ruled by systems thinkers. Archimedes knew it was about deploying great systems. And as a as an executive leader, are you thinking in terms of systems? Now, I don't mean systematic or sequential. I mean related to and connected systems. What, in that time in my professional growth, that's when I stumbled onto this whole concept of systems thinking. So our next competency that we'll discuss for the coming weeks is proactive, holistic systems thinking. And when we talk about marshaling the human capital of those we're responsible for, remember human capital, right? Their time, their talent, their treasure, their sweat, their innovation, their creativity. How do I get 50 people? How do I get 100 people? How do I get 1,000 people giving me the best of their time, their talent, their treasure, their sweat, their energy? There's only one way. Great systems. Great systems. That's the only way. Do you have great systems? Do you even see the systems that are in play today within your department, within your organization, within your community, within our society? You see, that quote from Archimedes started me down a whole path. And you know what I came to realize? I came to realize that our whole world is a system. Our whole world, our whole universe. Doesn't it amaze you that the big ball of fire in the sky, millions of miles away, controls so much of what we do here? It's not connected, but yet it's connected. That if it moved 1 inch this way or 1 inch that way, it would completely change what goes on here. System, the solar system, the moon in the sky at night, its gravitational pull affecting the waves of the oceans to and fro. Doesn't that amaze you? System, I started to realize that the whole universe is a big system. Then there's biological systems like our body. You don't have to think about your heart beating right now. You don't have to think about breathing. You're not sitting there going, oh, I gotta breathe. Oh, I gotta make sure my heart pumps. Your heart will beat a billion times in your lifetime and you don't think about it once, for the most part. Because it's a system built, designed, whatever. And whether you believe in the hand of divine providence or you believe in cosmic coincidence, I don't know. That's on you. I just know this. It's a system. And for the most part, take care of it fairly well, it'll last 85 years. That's a hell of a deal. Because it's a system. Then there's mechanical systems like the thermostat that's over on the wall over there. That was designed. An integrated set of organized collection of parts that are deeply integrated to accomplish a specific goal. I walk over, turn it, it gets hot. I walk over, turn it, it gets cold. It's a system, mechanical systems. But then there's human mechanical interfaces, like a bicycle. A bicycle is a great example of a force multiplier, right? I can travel faster on a bicycle than I can on my own power. It's a system, highly integrated or highly organized collection of parts. Organized collection of parts that are highly integrated for a specific goal. How about ecological systems, like predator and prey on the Serengeti Plain, right? So the wildebeest is there, and then the lion comes and kills the wildebeest and eats the wildebeest, and then there's food for the hyena, and then the hyena comes and eats, and then the vultures come and eat, and then the bugs come and eat, and then eventually the body of the wildebeest decomposes, and the rain comes, and the grass grows, and the wildebeest eat. Wildebeest are eating themselves. It's kind of gross. Anyways, what's your point? My point is this. My point is the circle of life. If you have little kids, you know, circle of life. What's it, Lion King? So it's an ecological system. And it works and it operates for the most part on its own. But then there's social systems. Like within your department, there's some groups that work together, some groups that don't work together very well. There's cliques that get established. usually those systems sound something like this. I don't know, it's just what we do around here. You see, systems can either be designed for a specific purpose or grow up organically and take hold. And in either case, the question is, are they relevant? I don't know, it's just what we do around here. Or we develop that system for a specific purpose, but that purpose isn't relevant anymore. Systems. And they take hold, and the inertia is strong. And do we not reach our desired outcomes because we're not good or we got bad systems? Supply and demand, friendships, relationships, cliques. How about this one? I don't know. I'm just happy to be pregnant. My mom had me when she was 15. Her mom had her when she was 15. I don't know. It's just we're doctors. Just what we are. We're doctors. My dad was a doctor. His dad was a doctor. Systems. You can make the case that there's intangible systems in play that are intangible, but are rock solid in place. And I bet you have some in your department right now. Guaranteed, man. Guaranteed. That's not a value judgment. The question just is, are those systems serving you well? The systems that you use for onboarding employees, the systems that you use for the development of morale, the systems that you use for time management or maximizing utilization of time, the systems that you use for motivation or delegation, the systems that you use to tap into the collective intelligence, the systems that you use to come up with an innovative idea, the systems that you use. Are they force multipliers that help you get more done with less? Or are they systems that actually impede the deployment of human capital? See, the first step in this whole thing is understanding that systems are even in play, both tangible and intangible. Now, some of you are very, very astute at the tangible systems. Maybe you came up on the engineering side of things, so you're incredibly astute on the tangible systems. But you have no clue on the intangible systems, interpersonal communication, how to motivate another human being, and on and on and on. Those are just as tangible, intangible systems as anything else. The question is, can you see it? Can you do anything about it when you see that it's flawed? Systems thinking. That key word, those key phrases, force multipliers. Great systems are force multipliers. When you look at this whole concept of alignment, that the key to alignment is systems. The better your systems, the more likely alignment. The poorer your systems, the less likely of alignment. Great systems help unleash the human capital within your department. Poor systems restrict and impede human capital. Policies, procedures, these all relate to systems. But it begins with you being a systems thinker. When you say policies and procedures, Ian, is that what you mean by systems? To an extent. I mean, look at that. By definition, then, systems are systematic, meaning related to or affecting the entire system. Systemic. That's not to be confused with systematic, which also can merely, which can merely mean that something is methodological. Thus, methodological thinking, systematic thinking, does not necessarily mean systems thinking. A pile of rocks is not a system. Take out a pile of rock, take a rock out of the pile, and you still got a pile of rocks. A car engine is a system. You take out the carburetor, the system fails. Now, Capra said that there had to be a shift. For us as executive leaders, there had to be a shift towards systems thinking. From parts, little parts, to looking at the whole. From things to relationships. from structure to the process, from the hierarchy to the network, from the rationale to the intuitive, from the analysis, what just happened, to the creation. That's why it's proactive, holistic, big picture thinking. Systems thinking is the second competency of today's highly effective leader. Now, that's a lot of lead up, but I'll finish it with this. Senge said it pretty well, I think. Business and human endeavors are systems. We tend to focus on snapshots of isolated parts of the system and wonder why our deepest problems never get solved. I think there's significant truth to that. And whether it's within your department or whether it's in our communities or within our nations, I think there's great truth in that. So are you a systems thinker? Well, let's take a little test, quickly. Let's take a little test. Because my job over the coming weeks, and I think because of the holiday, it's more than 3 weeks. My job over the coming weeks is to introduce some systems to you. Systems that from a big picture executive leader standpoint will assist you in marshaling that human capital and aligning the time, talent, and treasure of all of your staff members for maximum impact. So I've got to get you, I've got to expose you to various systems in an attempt to help you be a better systems thinker. So but before we do that, let's take the little test. So I'm gonna read these, and you have to forgive me, man. I'm like in a fog today with this flu. But sorry about that. But hang in there with me, if you would, please. I understand there's a symbiotic relationship between human beings. Now, one, I totally do not get that, or 10, I totally understand that. Symbiotic relationship, right? That's the big whale fish and the little fish around it. They are connected. Their existence are connected. My life and your life are connected. Even though we're thousands of miles apart, perhaps. The way you raise your kids, the way you run your department, the way you run your life directly impacts me. The way I raise my kids, the way I run my life directly impacts you, even though our kids may never bump into each other. There's a symbiotic relationship between us. I can apply strategies for learning about a group, its key stakeholders, and its resources. For me to be able to better understand the human dynamic, the human systems, I got to understand people. I can demonstrate knowledge of the roles and responsibility of employees, departments, and governmental entities. Again, there's that symbiotic relationship between departments within our governmental entity, neighboring governmental entities, regional governmental entities, state or provincial governmental entities, federal governmental entities. It's all related to, it's all connected. It's funny how we think we've become highly civilized and we think we can do things on our own, but we're more interdependent than we've ever been. I demonstrate knowledge of social capital, organizational and community assets, physical, human, financial, and environmental. You know, the guy that runs the Ford dealership is a community stakeholder. You got to have a relationship with them. You saw that email that I sent out a couple of weeks ago or a couple of days ago. You got to have a trusting relationship with the Rotary Club. You got to have a trusting relationship with the governmental official on the regional level. You got all of these various stakeholders that you need on side with the mindset or attitude of the value and importance of public works. Because if they're not on side, then you can't fulfill your vital and important role. And they're not going to just get it. You're going to have to go out there and evangelize the message. I can apply techniques that will generate a creative outside-the-box thinking. Can you come up with a good idea? Or do you know how to facilitate the development of a good idea within your department? We're going to talk about that today. You shouldn't be the only one. You and your executive team should not be the only ones coming up with good ideas. You stop and think about that. You have tons of PhDs in your department. It takes 10,000 hours to get a PhD. And I guarantee you, you have within your department a whole bunch of people that have put in 10,000 hours in what they do. They've put in 10,000 hours of what they do. If you've got a whole bunch of people in your department that have put in 10,000 hours of what they do, which would be 5 years or more, right? 2,080 hours of full-time work a year. 2,080 hours of full-time work a year. So if they're 5 years or more, they got 10,000 hours. They got PhDs, vocational and operational PhDs. Do you have a way to come up with a creative idea with that? If you don't have a good system for tapping into that collective intelligence, then I would say you're not doing your job as an executive leader. Huh? I got an open door policy. That's a joke, dude. Open door policy is a joke. And I'll talk about that more in a second. I'm aware of my department's culture or DNA. I can facilitate the development of teams and coalitions to work proactively to address common goals. I understand how to create organizational culture. I can facilitate the development of systems and processes that will foster an environment that supports success. I understand how to take ideas of my people and prioritize them and implement them and have a system to do so. I have an open door policy, which means you sit in your office and wait for somebody to walk in the door. I have a proactive process to identify thoughts, ideas, and concerns, prioritize the best of them, and then have a way to implement. That's a process for tapping into the collective intelligence. I'm aware of what motivates others. I can apply strategies to motivate others. Look at this little quote. If any of the parts or activities in a system are weakened or misaligned, the system will fail. That's a pretty good indictment on our society today. 85% of poor performance is usually systems-based. It's usually systems-based. I don't think people get up in the morning and get in their car and say, I want to do a crappy job at work today. Which means 85% of poor performance rests on you and me, the executive leaders, to create great systems that will unleash human capital. And the amazing thing about great systems is they exponentially unlock human capital and deploy human capital. They are force multipliers. They are the fulcrum and lever. That's why Archimedes said, give me a place to stand and I will move the world. Just give me a fulcrum big enough, give me a lever big enough, and I'll move the whole damn world, dude. And with my compound pulley, I can pull what it would take 20 men to pull, a force multiplier. Do you have systems that force multiply in your department? The guy who invented the internet, not Al Gore, said that his vision was, there's an advertisement for Hardee's or Carl's Jr.'s, depending on where you are in the United States, right? Nothing better than iced tea or tea with honey and vinegar to help you. The vinegar kills the virus. Yeah, it's not true, but that's what my wife tells me, so I gotta drink this vinegar. Maybe the vinegar kills me, and then there's a whole big life insurance thing, I don't know. Listen to this, what the hell was I talking about? Internet, oh yeah. So the guy who invented the internet basically said, his vision was, could I deeply integrate 5 people? Because if I could do that, they could probably do the work of 25 people. A lot to be said for that. System to maximize human capital. Okay, so stop and think about in your department, do you have systems that maximize human capital? Do you have systems that will take and make the most out of everybody on your team? And whether that's a system for the recruitment and retention of great people, even if you're hiring anybody, some of you are not, system for educating people, a system for high morale, a system for coaching, performance management, and on and on and on and on. So my job over the next couple weeks is to introduce you to systems. Why? Well, what I realized on that bed that night that I was crying because I was overwhelmed and I knew I couldn't lead. What I've got to try to do is get you to realize what I realized was that I could choose the system I deployed. I had choice. I had the power to choose. And as long as I chose relevant, impactful systems, I could lead. So was it about my skill, my talent, my knowledge, my ability? Did I have to be a brainiac? Did I have to be a guru? Did I have to be the best of the best of the best? No. I just needed to understand that I had a choice and I could deploy the right system and the systems at the time required. And as long as I was deploying the systems at the times required, I was probably going to be highly successful because I was going to bring people into alignment. And if I could bring people into alignment and get the best of their time, talent, treasure, energy, sweat, creativity, innovation, and the like, the best of their human capital, then I would be successful as a leader. And that was the simplicity of it. And for me, that was incredibly freeing. That was a golden nugget that Archimedes gave me. And I thank him. And he and I talk regularly, my boy Archimedes. You say, you're drunk. No, I'm not drunk. That NyQuil, I did not drink NyQuil today. Remember when Howard Cosell drank NyQuil, he got drunk on air? I didn't do that. So over the next few weeks, I'm going to try to unpack a number of systems. I'm going to talk to you about how to think outside the box, because I think creative thinking is a system. It is that organized set of parts, sequence of questions that lead to an innovative idea. That if you sequence your questions appropriately, that they will lead you more times than not to a creative idea. We don't come up with creative ideas very much. I want to provide you, and I will in a few minutes, a system of proactive listening, a comprehensive system to identify thoughts, ideas, and concerns. A proactive system. I want to provide you a system for motivation. How do I motivate people and move them down the road? And then we'll put up some other systems as well in the portal that you can access, a system on time management or maximizing utilization of your time and the like. These systems hopefully will be relevant, but just as importantly, if not more importantly, they'll just get you in the mindset of systems thinking. And then you start looking around your department and analyzing the systems. Now, this is the same conversation, or the systems conversation, we'll be having with your mid-level leaders and your frontline people to get the whole department thinking systems. And do we have good systems? And are we deploying good systems? And are we utilizing good systems? And so on and so on and so on. Now, the systems that your mid-level leaders will look at, systems of delegation, systems of motivation, systems of how to utilize their time, will be different than the systems that you may be looking at. But they'll be looking at systems nonetheless. And the same will be true with your frontline employees. The whole attempt here over the next few weeks is to get everybody looking at the systems that we utilize. All right, turn the page. Why? Because I am of the deep belief that the better our systems, the exponential impact. They are force multipliers. When we have a great system in place, we absolutely can do more with less. And I'm not just talking about the tangible systems. I'm talking more about the intangible systems. How do I motivate a human being? How do we generate a great idea? How do we gather thoughts, ideas, and concerns and do something with them? And on and on and on. Performance management and so on. Delegation and the like. Or just how do I maximize the use of my time? These systems are seemingly intangible, and yet they're highly tangible and make significant impact. Force multipliers. What are the force multipliers that you're using personally in your own leadership ability or your own leadership role? Or what are the force multipliers you have in place within the strategy of how to make maximum impact for your department? If you don't have force multipliers, then you will succumb to the challenge of our day, which is not enough time, not enough energy, not enough resources at your disposal to get done everything you need to get done. So you can either quit or you can come up with some force multipliers like Archimedes did. He couldn't move the 500-pound stone, so he came up with a force multiplier to move the stone. He didn't say it's impossible to move the stone. As he looked at the boat in the bay, he didn't say it's impossible for me to move that boat in here. He came up with the compound pulley. Impossible is an opinion. The guys with the biggest books, the guys with the most letters after their name, the guys with all the fancy degrees at the time said the world was flat. Impossible is an opinion. Give me a place to stand and I will move the world. I can choose the right system that needs to be deployed. All right, so there's a couple of systems, but I look at the clock and we have about 20 minutes. So here's what I wanna do. I'm gonna send you an email that talks about outside the box thinking. I'll send you an email that will talk about motivation and a system, an effective system for motivation. So that outside the box thinking is, do you personally have a way to come up with a good idea? Do you personally have a way that you generate ideas that are outside the norm, innovative, creative? Not just rearranging the numbers. You've heard me maybe say it before, you know, that most of us just do 1 + 2 + 3 + 4 and that equals 10. And then we're going to get creative and innovative, and we do this. We do, which way am I going? Oh, yeah, there we go. You know, we do 2 + 3 + 1 + 4. And we think we're going to get a different answer. We call that innovation. That's not innovation. So how do you come up with an innovative idea? I'll give you a system that'll take you to a sequence of thinking that will get you more likely than not to an innovative idea. And then we'll give you a system for motivating human beings in your department. How do we move people into action? Motivation is the most over-discussed, misunderstood aspect of leadership that there is today. And it's not about fiery pep talks, and it's not about rah, 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 sis, boom, bah. Not today. So we'll give you a system for motivation. But in the balance of our time, I want to give you a system for identifying thoughts, ideas, and concerns. Here's the simplicity of it. You have a bunch of people in your department that have operational and vocational expertise and knowledge, just like I did. I had 1,000, 1,100, depending on the time of the year, we had between 1,000 and 1,200 people that I was responsible for. And it dawned on me one day, as I was racking my brain trying to come up with a good idea, that I was a fool. That I wasn't possibly going to come up with a good idea every day, let alone every week, let alone every month, let alone, hell, every quarter. I was not going to come up with a great idea. So if everybody was waiting on me to come up with a great idea, we were in trouble. Because frankly, I wasn't that innovative. And what dawned on me was, I don't need to come up with a great idea. I just need to create a system that generates ideas. And what if I could get 1,000 people thinking of ideas? Or 1,000 people identifying concerns? Or 1,000 people sharing their thoughts with me? That eventually I'd come up with something good. Now, what would I root that in? I'd root that in the fact, what would I root that assumption that I would come up with something good? I would root that in this fact. The fact is that there was operational expertise, there was vocational knowledge, there was insight and wisdom amongst all of those people, and that some of them had, as I alluded to earlier, PhDs. Some of them had PhDs, 10,000 hours in the work. And many of them had twice that. They had 10 years and 15 years and 20 years. 20 years. That'd be 40,000 hours of something. And was I tapping into that? The concept is the collective intelligence. Was I tapping into the collective intelligence? And that's when it dawned on me. I don't need to have a great idea. I just need to tap into that 40,000 hours of expertise, or the 20,000 hours of knowledge and insight, or the 10,000 hours of vocational wisdom. And did I have one? And I said, yes. It's called an open door policy and a suggestion box. I got a suggestion box over there, and I got an open door policy. Well, what got in the suggestion box was gum and gum wrappers, and nobody walked in the open door. And that's when I said, I got to change this thing, man. And that's when I came up with, and you have the diagram, a system for gathering thoughts, ideas, and concerns. You see, if I could get 1,000 people to share with me their thoughts, 1,000 people to share with me their ideas, and 1,000 people to share with me their concerns proactively, then something of quality was going to bubble up to the top. And all I needed was a good idea a quarter. If I had a good idea a quarter, I looked like a hero. So that was it. That was the simplicity of it. The diagram that you have in front of you now is the summation, or the synthesis of that. You see, I realized that if I wanted to gather thoughts, ideas, and concerns, and I was going to create a system to do so, then I had to take two approaches. I had to take an informal approach and a formal approach. An informal approach and a formal approach. Now, again, I'm sharing a system with you to provoke some thought around the systems that you use to tap into the collective intelligence. That's not the Borg. It's not Star Trek, the Borg. Collective intelligence, that just means this. That means you got a lot of smart people out there with a lot of expertise, vocational competency, and how are you bringing that forward? Proactively. How are you creating a context that comes forward? So I realized some people will respond better to an informal approach. Some people will respond better to a formal approach. So I knew my system had to have both. I'm going to use my board here in a second. So let's look at the informal approach first. So I had to have my hand on the pulse. And look, so I had to have a formal or informal and a formal approach. On the informal side, I had to have my hand on the pulse as an executive leader. So I had to identify people of influence in each one of the stakeholder groups. We talked about that the other day when we color-coded them red, yellow, and green. And I had to build a trusting relationship with those people of influence out there in the community. When I say in the community, I mean my department, stakeholders. But it might have been in the broader community, might have been outside of my department. So I had my hand on the pulse. I knew exactly what was going on. So it wasn't being filtered between me and supervisors. Oh, you're talking about going around my people's back? I'm not saying that. I'm just saying I want to have multiple lines of communication to me. And then I was going to go out and proactively utilize Deming's approach of management by walking around, out to the water treatment plant, out to the fleet yard, out to these different places. Now, the way I did it was I took that seemingly informal approach and structured it, and made sure that I was scheduled to be in certain places at certain times so that I would make it through all of the 56 or 70 or whatever the heck it was departments. I cycled through them over a 2-month period, and I spent a little informal time in each place. Cup of coffee in my hand, a soda in my hand, walking around saying hi to people, just checking things out. But it was structured so that I scheduled myself. I made an appointment with myself to get out to those places. It was a high leverage activity. It provided a greater return than the time invested, because when I was out there, I could look in people's eyes. I could do quality control. I could check morale, and I could gather thoughts, ideas, and concerns. Now, what do you mean by the chat, Ian? So make a note of this, the chat. It's 80% listening, 20% talking. I'm doing nothing but asking open-ended questions and then listening. Listening with my ears, listening with my eyes, listening with my intuition. When I'd walk into a department or an area, I could tell how people were feeling just by the, if they'd make eye contact with me. How's it going around here? If everybody looks at the floor, you know it's going crappy. Yeah, but I don't want to undermine my supervisors. I don't want to sabotage them or circumvent their authority. You walking in the area is not circumventing anybody's authority. Come on. Get out and be with your people and evangelize the message and the worth of the quality of the department. Evangelize the importance of the work that they do. Don't outsource being magnanimous. What do you mean by that? Only you can go around and shake somebody's hand and tell them they're doing a great job. You're the big boss. Don't outsource that to somebody. I don't have time for all this, Ian. Okay, well then you don't have time to marshal human capital or gather thoughts, ideas, and concerns. Now, because it was a system, it was manageable. So what I did was I got out there and talked with people, but I only did 20% of the talking, but I did 80% of the listening. I just asked open-ended questions. How's it going? How do you like this? How do you not like this? Just open-ended question, let people talk. Shut your mouth. Just listen. But that in and of itself, the informal approach, even though it was systematic, even though I rotated through all the departments, was not enough. Because that only gave me one sliver. Just because everybody looked at the floor when I walked in the door, I wasn't going to say everybody was poorly managed. Smarter than that, more sophisticated than that. So I would take that information in my informal walk arounds, and I'd put it right here in the middle. You see it right there in the middle. But then I knew I had to have another approach. I had to have a more formal approach to the communication strategy. A more formal approach. And that more formal took two branches. Anonymous, face-to-face. Anonymous, face-to-face. Anonymous, well, if somebody's not going to put their name to it, I ain't listening. That's ridiculous, dude. That goes with the open-door policy nonsense. The most challenging and difficult situations that you've ever dealt with, probably, if you had known early on that the situation was brewing, you probably could have handled it. And it wouldn't have become the challenge that it became for you. And why didn't you know? Because nobody told you. Why didn't they tell you? Because they were afraid, or they were nervous, or they were scared, or they were whatever. So they didn't tell you. And why didn't they tell you? Because they didn't trust the situation, they didn't trust the process, they didn't trust you, they didn't feel safe, and on and on and on. That's why I do think you need that anonymous. Now, anonymous can be suggestion boxes. Anonymous can be electronic surveys. Anonymous can be written surveys that people don't have to put their name on. But for those things to be effective, I think there has to be a couple of key pieces in play. One, they have to be responded to in a timely manner. And I don't care if that's 2 months. When you empty the suggestion box, every one of the suggestions must be addressed. Now, why don't we want to do that? Because it creates a lot of work for us. Agreed. I don't disagree with that. It does create work. But I came to the conclusion that if it was worth the work if I just got one good idea. Yeah, but Ian, no, they never put a good idea in there. That's because they don't trust the process. They don't trust that anybody will do anything with it, which I'll show you in a moment. And the system takes that into account. So you tell them the time frame. You can expect us to respond within 30 days, within 45 days, within 6 months. Doesn't matter. Just make sure whatever that time frame is, you can meet that time frame. And then everything gets addressed with either one of three responses. Yes, no, not right now. See, not everything's going to be a yes. There are crappy ideas. There are concerns that are brought forward that aren't concerns, that are nonsense. So it's either yes, no, not right now. Yes, that's a great idea. Thank you so much. No, we are absolutely not doing that for these reasons. And not right now. We need to gain more information about that. So when using the surveys or when using the suggestion box or whatever, yes, no, not right now. And then just tell them when you're going to respond. We're going to respond in 45 days. We're going to respond in 6 months, whatever. Just whatever it is you tell them, make sure you respond. And then people begin to trust the process. And as people begin to trust the process, what will they do? Participate in the process. But if people think the process is a joke or that it's rigged or nothing will come out of what they say, then of course they won't use it, and neither would you. That's the biggest challenge we face. We have literally thousands of PhDs all across North America in the public work sector, frontline and mid-level employees and leaders who have been in the game for 20 and 25 years, and we're not coming up with any good ideas. Or they're on a limited basis where we're just rearranging 2 + 3 + 4 + 1. I'm not being disparaging, I'm just saying, do we really have systems that really tap into the collective intelligence to solve our most challenging problems? No, in my opinion. You can put in the chat box if you think I'm full of shit. Excuse my language. And side note, we're going to go 2 or 3 minutes over. Work with me. I have the flu, please. Thank you. Give me a break. You're lucky I'm even here. Okay, so that's the anonymous. But I knew that we also had to have that face-to-face. So what does that look like? I call them roundtable meetings. You can call them whatever you want. But it's where the executive leader sits with line employees in small group. Now, you could do small group amongst work groups, or you could do small group amongst interdisciplinary, right? You have, you know, representatives from a couple of different work groups who work with each other. Or you could just do the fleet yard, or you could just do the water treatment, or you could just do the guys out on the plows, or you could just do admin or engineering or whatever. Park and rec, or park, maybe not rec, but park, depending on what's in your portfolio. And I just made sure my admin assistant rotated me through all of the different departments. Now, what did that meeting look like? You know what it looked like? It looked just like this. Me and a notepad. And we had some, maybe some food and some waters and some drinks. And I just listened. I didn't try to justify things. I didn't explain things there. And they knew that. You're just coming to give me thoughts, ideas, and concerns for the next 45 minutes to an hour. Thoughts, ideas, and concerns. I do 80% of the listening, 20% of the talking. I ask nothing but open-ended questions. And usually the open-ended questions sounded something like this. Okay, everybody, what's frustrating you? Okay, everybody, what pisses you off? Okay, everybody, what do you think we could do better around here? And then I just took notes. I just took notes. I didn't try to, it wasn't a town hall meeting. I wasn't pushing information out, just gathering, gathering, gathering. Now look at what we've done when you look at it here. I've got a face-to-face mechanism for gathering thoughts, ideas, and concerns. I've got an anonymous way for gathering thoughts, ideas, and concerns, and I got an informal way for gathering thoughts, ideas, and concerns. And I pull those all together. And what am I looking for? I'm looking for trends. What am I looking for? I'm looking for consistent. I saw it when I was walking around. It was validated in the surveys and in the meetings I'm having face-to-face, it's validated again. You know what? It's probably true. So I'm not flying off the handle just because I see something when I'm walking around. I'm validating that. I'm trusting the system to vet the information to make sure it's sound. That creates a lot of work. Yeah, but watch. What am I going to do with it now? Because usually that's where it stops. What now I got to do is I got to prioritize those. When I see those trends, when I see them consistently, I heard this idea when I was walking around. It got suggested in the suggestion box, and in the face-to-face meeting, it came forward as well. So I can prioritize those. Now, who does that? You, your executive team, I don't care. But somebody looks at all that information, the aggregate, and then pulls out the best idea, or the greatest concern, or the most profound thought, prioritizes those. But now what? That's the challenge. Now what? What the hell do we do with that now, Ian? And this is the piece that I think is so critical in this system. What do you do with that idea now? What do you do with that concern now? There's not enough time and energy, Ian. That just generates a whole bunch of work. So it's better not to even ask. I would disagree. I would suggest to you that's the next key to this thing. The task force. Now, I call it a task force. I go back to the stakeholders that bubbled up the idea, the concern, or the thought. and I say, this is a good one, or this is one that needs to be addressed, you know, concern, this is a bad one, we have to address it, or this is a great idea, who will help us come up with the solution? Who will put in a little bit of time and energy? If nobody raises their hand, if nobody wants to help, then guess what? Fine. It's obviously not too important to them. But some people raise their hand, I got my task force. Now, what's the task force's job? It is not the task force's job to implement. It is not the task force's job to come up with policy. It is the task force's job to take the idea and build out a plan, or take the idea or the concern and make recommendations. If you look at implementing change that I talked about in the last 3 weeks, last 4 weeks, give me some ideas of how you could structure that. A group of stakeholders who are charged with taking the idea, the thought, or concern and coming up with a plan and recommendation for action. Recommendation for action. So you guys think this is important? Come up with a recommendation for action. We, the executive leaders, will look at that recommendation for action and take it into account. If you think about the principles of implementing of change, task list, timeline, simple task list and timeline of what you would do with that idea. So now that stakeholder group has done what? Self-determination, self-reliance. They came up with an idea, and then we facilitated them coming up with an implementation plan, task list, timeline. That task force is key. And then what? Then we go implement. Now think about the dynamic of that. So I proactively went out and gathered thoughts, ideas, and concerns, both anonymously and then, both informally and then formally, anonymously and face-to-face. That bubbled up some ideas, thoughts, and concerns. We prioritized them, and we took the ones that would have the greatest impact, the negative ones that if we rectified impact would have the most positive impact, or the idea or thought that if implemented would have the most positive impact. But then we didn't implement it. We talked to the stakeholders and said, okay, it's what you all said. Who wants to take this on? Then we gathered a group of people who said, I'm in. They took it on. They implemented it. They came up with some recommendations, a task list, a timeline. We looked at it. The recommendation was sound. And then we used that mastering the power of change approach system for implementing the change. And the next thing you know, we had positive change that occurred. Who owns that? They own that. Do they trust the system to a greater degree? Hell yes, they trust the system to a greater degree. Do they feel like the system is valuable? And will they be more likely to participate in it? Yes, of course they will. Ian, that takes a hell of a lot of work. Totally agree. But for me, the system produced exponential impact, not only with a good idea, but also self-determination, self-reliance. Morale went up, trust in the organization increased, and I had marshaled human capital to a greater degree than I had the day before, all revolving around gathering thoughts, ideas, and concerns, and having a system to do so. Now, over the next few weeks, because of the holidays, you know, we're going to be a little bit longer than we would our normal 3 weeks. So I'm going to send out a video about this so you can continue to think it through. But at minimum, ask yourself, how do you gather thoughts, ideas, and concerns? How do you tap into the literally thousands upon thousands of hours of operational expertise, insight, and vocational knowledge that you have at your disposal? And if you don't have a way to do that, you are a fool, man. You're a fool. And it must be a system, because if it's not, it's highly unlikely that it'll get done. Now, I'm going to show you some other systems. We're going to talk through other systems for sure. So keep your eyes open for those. All right, I'll be in the chat box for the next few minutes. Sorry, we went a little long. Systems, it's the key to being successful today. Thanks a lot, everybody.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down. I'm gonna make this place your